Well, another month, another monthly prayer breakfast with Sheriff Daniel Edwards, and we're in Pumpkin Center right now, which is part of the parish that is very heavily populated, but is an unincorporated area, so its law enforcement is squarely under the TPSO.
Yes, it is, and let me start by saying to Trinity Baptist Church and Pastor Avery Dixon, I do appreciate them opening their doors and allowing us to come here this morning. I think the last time we were at this church, Ken, I think it was in 2018, but it's really glad to be back here. You're right, Pumpkin Center is a growing area. It's you know, when I was growing up as a kid, it was sparsely populated, but now it's quite heavily populated. A lot of people here, a lot of people moving here, a lot of nice homes. It is an unincorporated area. That means we're responsible for all of the law enforcement here, and I've already spoken to one gentleman this morning who just wanted me to know that they could use some extra patrols in the General Ott subdivision, and that's not an uncommon request, but in any event, that's the only thing I've heard so far this morning. I may hear more as the morning goes on.
So you're going to leave office with a big problem squarely unsolved for the Sheriff's Department. You're one of the least funded departments in the entire state, and that is going to fall on your successor, because you have these very heavily populated so-called rural areas that are really not rural at all, and you're having to do what a municipal police force would do.
Well, that's true, Ken, and it certainly is very challenging for our department with the resources that we have, you know, to try to go into heavily populated areas, you know, outside of towns and provide the law enforcement services, not just that's adequate, but the type of law enforcement services that people want. And it all goes back to, I'm not a believer that money solves everything, but I do know it takes a certain amount of money to provide, you know, services when you're dealing with, you know, hiring police officers or what we call deputies and giving them patrol cars and training them and insurance. And all that is a very, very expensive proposition. And what you just said is we as a sheriff's office per capita rank among the bottom of funding in the entire state of Louisiana. That's not going to change anytime soon until a new tax gets passed. I tried to pass a tax in 2011, I think it was. It was a jail tax, but the way the tax was structured, it would have saved the sheriff's office a lot of money that we'd spend now into the jails that we could have put into enforcement. We would have been able to hire some more deputies. We would have been able to hire some more detectives, and we would have been able to pay better. But that just didn't pass. I get it. The voters said no, not now. And so we just buckled down, and we're trying to do the best we can do with the resources we have.
You mentioned the jail. How is it coming? Because there are challenges there, to say the least.
Well, yeah, the jail is old. It has a lot of maintenance issues. It has issues with us not being able to segregate inmates as much as we would like to. Certainly when some get in trouble, Ken. Sometimes you have gang members in there and you need to be able to separate them. Our jail is not set up to allow us to be able to do those things. But currently, since you brought it up, we're having issues with water. Under our north wing, you know, that we know that's there's a water leak somewhere. We're trying to ascertain what type of leak that is. That could be from a chill water system. It could be from the water supply line. We don't know. But right now, the parish, being headed up by Joe Thomas, is working very, very hard to try to identify that leak to see what it's going to take to fix it. It could be a big issue for us, or it could be a minor issue. But there's always something going on at the jail from a maintenance standpoint.
You know, when I speak with deputies who work there, they all say the same thing. A big part of the maintenance issue is that these inmates, they tear things up. And sometimes it's amazing how much property damage they do.
Well, that's true. I mean, certainly they can be unruly and they can tear things up. And I can tell you, Ken, when we catch them tearing things up and can prove who it is, you know, even though they're in jail, they get arrested again on that new charge of destruction of public property. And, you know, we forward to the DA's office and ask them to charge them and you know, try to go the distance with them, just so there's some accountability for inmates who try to destroy property that belongs to the government.
So we had an opening of school, and all sources agree that it went very smoothly, which after Hurricane Ida, the pandemic, and all the rest, smooth is good.
Smooth is real good, and I can say I'm extremely pleased with how smoothly school went. Again, you know, I only got a couple calls, and it really related to traffic, people getting acclimated, I guess, into the best way to get into the, you know, lines to either drop off or pick up. But overall, it's going very smoothly. Had very, very few calls for additional service, and it kind of transitioned to say that, you know, certainly you're always concerned about juvenile crime. You know, it's the trend has always been up, but, you know, just looking back over the past maybe couple months, you know, I don't think juvenile crime, even though it's, you know, it's steady, I don't think we saw the escalation that we were fearing about.
It's always worse in the summer, but not this year.
That's correct. It seemed to always be worse in the summer. And, of course, you remember when school let out last year, the shooting, right, at the university, at Hammond High's graduation. But since that time, you know, yes, it's still active and ongoing juvenile crime, but I certainly don't think that it's continued to peak. And maybe, somehow, we're kind of turning the corner with juvenile crime. I know it's too early to say that, but I will say that we didn't have as many calls, I guess, as I feared we would have for the rest of the summer.
So what are you seeing in terms of crime? Because it's been relatively quiet, or so it would appear.
Well, what we're seeing in crime, Ken, we're seeing some thefts, just standard thefts. If people leave something of value outside their home or just don't secure it somewhere, we're seeing some residential burglaries, some car burglaries. And then on top of that, it's just your drug cases where people are, trying to get prescription pills or even fake prescription pills, if you can understand what that is. That's pills that individuals learn to press and they made to look like it came, from a drugstore. So a lot of the overdoses that we see today, we all know that most of those are caused by fentanyl because it's fentanyl that is put in those kind of pills. So people who believe when they buying these pills off the streets, a lot of times those are not real pills, Ken. They are laced with fentanyl. And, of course, that's why you see in some people overdose there. So it's pills, they basically right now, and then heroin. Those are our two biggest as it relates to the drug trade.
Well, that's pretty bad news because those are the two worst drugs if you had to rank them. I mean, nobody's going to die smoking marijuana, for example, whereas both of these, heroin and fentanyl, they will kill you.
Absolutely. And so, like I said, when you see or hear that someone has OD'd, Ken, I mean, I'm going to say it's 80 to 90% of the time it's because that drug that they took somehow contained fentanyl. So the message is, certainly we all say, say no to drugs, stay away from drugs. But certainly if you don't know what's in those drugs, and I don't know how you can without test strips and whatnot. And by the way, they do have test strips that people can get to test for the presence of fentanyl. But if you don't know what's in those drugs, it is literally a crapshoot that you're taking with your life on the line.
So is it fair to say that crime has come down a bit? Because a year ago, the surge in crime was the biggest story in the country.
Well, I think crime probably is certainly lower than it was for the last year and a half or 2 years. I know that we'll get some stats on that probably at the beginning of the next quarter. It'd be easier to see. From a homicide level, we've had quite a few shootings, but we haven't had a high number of homicides. I think we were either two or three on the year. Now that the sheriff's office has worked, and overall that is that number is reduced from where we would have been this time last year. That's strictly on homicides. So to sit there and tell you from the top of my head all classifications are down, I can't say that, but I certainly don't think the trend went up, and I think the stats will prove that out.
It's just our population has certainly increased. I mean, that's a good thing.
Well, the population is always growing. I think Tangipahoa Parish, ever since I've been sheriff, over 18 years now, I think we've been in the top five parishes from a growth standpoint. So if you're going to be in the top five parishes from a growth standpoint for 18 years, you can imagine, how many new people you're going to have and how much you've grown. But that is great.
It's sobering. The Amite Courthouse was built for less than half the population we have now.
Well, I agree with you. I know there's some people who say they need a new courthouse, and I'm not saying they don't. The only thing I can say, as sheriff, this is my opinion, there's no public building needed more than a new jail. And that's something that the parish is going to have to figure out, along with the help of others, how to get that done.
What else do you want to share with us?
Well, Ken, it's just we got the football games going to be coming up. We got Hot August Nights right around the corner. Again, your sheriff's office is going to be out, certainly providing protection. Go out, enjoy yourself, have a good time. Be responsible. Do not drink and drive ever. And I think we'll all be safer and we'll all be better for it.
Well, we're in Pumpkin Center, which is sort of the stomping grounds of Heath Martin from the Sheriff's Office. This was Sheriff Daniel Edwards' monthly prayer breakfast site. And, I'm sure Pumpkin Center, as your family's from here, it's close to your heart.
It certainly is. Lots of family around here. The Martins come to Pumpkin Center in 1842 with however many great-grandfather it was, Nicholas Martin.
So it's a very densely populated area, more so than some cities, yet there are not municipal services, and that means the TPSO is law enforcement here.
Yes, even though we are downtown Pumpkin Center, it's still considered a pretty rural area, yes.
So how does the Sheriff's Office handle the challenge of thousands of people in this densely populated area, and you've got to do what a municipal police force does?
Well, we have very dedicated officers that respond to these calls of service. We do the best we can with the resources that we have, and we just move forward.
So are there some particular law enforcement challenges in Pumpkin Center?
There certainly are, yes. The growing population here, accessibility, there's a lot of traffic on these highways out here. So there is a lot of challenges.
So the answer is going to be money. You're announced candidate for sheriff, or at least maybe not formally announced, but it's clear that the next administration is going to have to address the funding issue.
Certainly that's going to have to be addressed. Of course, we'll have to go through the current budget, see how we can fix that before we can move forward and seeing if we're going to do anything else.
So that brings us to your day job, which is at the jail where you're the warden, and big challenges there in construction, including recently a water leak.
Yes, there is a water leak there right now, and the parish government is working diligently in trying to fix that. But us as the sheriff's office who maintain the facility, or not maintain the facility, but cover the correction side of it, we have worked in conjunction with Department of Corrections, and we are set that way if there is any chance of losing water at the jail, that we're able to attend our offenders there and get them to a location where they can receive the quality of care and custody that they are deserving.
But it illustrates that this is an old facility that really needs to be raised to the ground and then replaced, and there are construction issues every day.
Well, it's certainly maintained every day. It's a constant job, and yes, it's an old facility. Those decisions right now they're above my pay grade, but certainly it's a challenge for not only the sheriff's office to operate, but for the parish government to maintain and keep up to date.
So what else are you seeing at the jail?
Well, right now we have an outbreak of COVID again. Seems like that's never going to go away. But we are maintaining that right now. We have our people quarantined. We have no serious injuries or illnesses in relation to that. So we have our people quarantined. We're coming to the end of that 5-day quarantine, which is mandated to us for those prisoners that are positive for COVID.
So during this 2 years of the pandemic, or maybe more, I mean, the jail's been almost locked down. I mean, you can't visit a person in jail.
Yes, and that's correct. And that not only is that for the offender, but that's for our employees, as well as the general public that's wanting to come in. It creates certain challenges, of course, to attorneys that need to visit their clients. We do a lot of business by Zoom. But yes, it's a challenge to provide, that visitation and that personal touch that we used to provide.
So how about vaccines? Are they made available to the inmates?
Yes, they have the availability to be vaccinated. Matter of fact, requests are sent out through the population regularly on those who want to be vaccinated. And there are many who have accepted that and have been vaccinated, yes.
But again, if we're looking for COVID to go to zero, I think we'll be waiting a long time.
No, sir, I don't think it'll ever go away, really, honestly. My personal opinion is going to be just like influenza. It'll be here, and I think herd immunity is going to be a big part of it, of it going to bed. But I think we're going to have that challenge for many, many years to come.
What else would you tell us about the jail these days, which is so vitally important, but we don't hear about it much?
Well, our jail, we're constantly dealing with the crowding issue. And that's certainly a sign of the condition of our communities, that we need to pay a little more attention to those in our area, try to be a little more influential on those who may be getting led astray, and being a little more active, a little more vocal in our governmental systems.
What else do you want to share with us?
Well, I greatly appreciate it being invited here and being at the prayer breakfast at Trinity Baptist Church in downtown Pumpkin Center. And I'm looking forward to the challenges of the day, Ken.
Riding in style is important to me, but so is having a reliable car. That's why I do business with Bill Hood Ford Lincoln. The Hood family has been around since 1929, tackling high car prices so you too can have a stylish and reliable car. I do business with these guys, and I can tell you the short drive is well worth it. A friendly staff and a huge selection of new and certified used cars and trucks means just one thing, super savings. I'm Cam Jordan, and when you drive a little, you'll save a lot at the Bill Hood Auto Group.
Well, another ribbon cutting from Mayor Pete Pinapinto, this one Lit Pizza. And you know what I love about this company is that they're an upper scale fast food, which means that Hammond is not only getting all the McDonald's type franchises, but we're being recognized as a cut above.
not only a cut above for just being an upscale fast food, but you know, the child and everyone wants to build your own pizza, right? And so you can come here with the children, or like myself, I just built two pizzas to bring home to the family. And it's just fun to do. It's a great place to be, and the food obviously is going to be great. So another great build out for Beasy Landry and his team. So thankful for what they do in our community, bringing people in, building facilities for them on properties that they acquire, and have done just a really great job. So Ozzie, thank him for bringing his company here. You know, we have Izzo's Burritos on the other side of town that he owns, which has been doing really well. And now we have Lit Pizza, which come on out and another great place to come out and dine and have a good time in Hammond, especially for your children. You know, let them come build their own pizza.
Well, and obviously it means economic development, and what generally happens is things breed like things. So this means that we'll be getting more restaurants.
You know, they don't seem to stop coming, do they? And we are so appreciative of them all, and even more so to the citizens and the folks that live around the area that come to Hammond and eat and shop and have fun. So we're really proud of our town and proud of the progress we've made over the last decades.
Well, one thing you hear from these chain restaurant owners is that Hammond invariably is the easiest place they have ever been to open a new business. That has to make you feel good.
Absolutely. I mean, we want to be user-friendly. I'm in construction with my past, and it's nothing better than being able to go to the building department when you start working on something like this, talking to the planning department, and hear yeses, what can we do to help you, rather than know why you cannot do this. So we try to make it user-friendly. We're always working to get better, and we're just really happy that Hammond is growing in the way that it has grown.
What about on the residential side? There are a couple of big subdivisions eyeing Hammond, and then there's the question, do we have too many apartments? You know, residents in a neighborhood, they may not want growth in that neighborhood.
And that's understandable. I mean, you know, apartments are scary for a lot of people because it really is based on the management of the apartments. I've been in apartment rental business since I've been 20 years old. And when you have problems with certain properties, it's generally the property management that causes the problems. If you run places right and keep your places updated and clean, you're not going to have a problem. And that's really where we stand with most of that. As far as citizens not wanting more apartments, you know, we are a college school. We do have 5 interstate accesses. So there are a lot of people that don't want to live in Baton Rouge, don't want to live in New Orleans, Slidell, even Covington, now that it's got so populated. And they would gladly move here, live, eat, and have fun here. But access to the interstate for a 20-minute ride to work is really incredible.
So in the meantime, what are you seeing when you look at the numbers on building permits, sales tax receipts, and the other indices of growth? There's got to be a recession coming at some point. Do you see it yet?
We haven't seen it yet. You know, obviously, you always have to anticipate the worst, what could happen. But, you know, gas prices are up. A lot of folks haven't been going on vacations, or at least as far. And they're spending more time at home and shopping locally. So we really do appreciate our citizens for doing that, and the surrounding area citizens in the rural areas that come here and shop. I mean, we really have great facilities and a great downtown. You know, number one main street in the nation out of 1,600 cities because of what we've done downtown. The owners of downtown, small businesses have come in and done what we're doing here today. Just create a good business atmosphere for the community and for themselves making money.
Well, we haven't talked about the airport in a while. I assume all systems are go there.
Everything's fine with the airport. We're still dealing with the Corps of Engineers on that piece on the southeast corner. Hopefully we'll be there soon and we can clear that property out so we can get a safety factor for these aircraft coming in or out.
Well, you never got quite all the hangars that you wanted. Might you in the second or the upcoming third term try to get more hangars there?
Well, I'll tell you, Representative Nikki Muscarella has been a big help in his leadership at the state level, and also other state level representatives and senators have come to our aid. We're going to be able to build 2 hangars here shortly because of the help from the state and Nikki, and we're really appreciative of all the work that he has done for us, as well as the other representatives and senators for the airport.
Well, I hear he's also working on a grant to get more streetlights especially downtown.
Yeah, he and I talked about that a few months ago, and that looks like that's going to work out for us with a few more lights added to downtown. If you notice, you go downtown, around town, energy's on its last phase since Ida, third phase of trying to get the rest of our lights up. So things are better. You know, it's hard to believe it's now a year that Ida's been passed, and everybody's pretty much getting back to normal for the most part.
What else do you want to tell us?
Just thankful, you know, for the business that's come here with Lit Pizza and so many other good businesses coming into town. As you know, yesterday we had a plasma business coming into town, pretty much saying that we'll bring in another $3 million through this business because of the plasma that they actually pay people to come in, and they give them the blood back. And the plasma is shipped off to Florida where they have a manufacturing facility. And pretty interesting concept. We'll talk about that later, but just a lot of good things going on in the city. A lot of tax dollars continue to stream through, which allows us to do the infrastructure projects we do. Since I've been in office, we've done $16 million worth of sewer projects, you know, so we're constantly working on a 200-year-old city and making it better every day.
Riding in style is important to me, but so is having a reliable car. That's why I do business with Bill Hood Ford Lincoln. The Hood family has been around since 1929, tackling high car prices so you too can have a stylish and reliable car. I do business with these guys, and I can tell you the short drive is well worth it. A friendly staff and a huge selection of new and certified used cars and trucks means just one thing, super savings. I'm Cam Jordan, and when you drive a little, you'll save a lot at the Bill Hood Auto Group.
Randy Bush is a school board member, also unabashedly a candidate for the state senate in the new district here in Tangipahoa. But first, you know, everybody wants to know, how did we do coming back to school? You know, with all the anticipation and the craziness of the last couple of years, it seems amazingly uneventful, and that's a good thing.
Ken, if you judge it by how many phone calls I've received in the last few days, it's been the best one since I've been a school board member, because usually I get these just incredible amounts of phone calls, but really it's been very, very, very quiet. So obviously we still can use more bus drivers. We still could get that better than when it's going, but so far so good.
Well, also, I mean, you on the school board did a lot of preparation for this semester, new discipline policies, a whole new transportation department, and more.
Well, you know, Ponchatoula went to a block schedule this year, so just think about what had to go into there. All the teachers that are leaving and coming back and transferring and got a new transportation director and Kim Notriano. So it's you just wouldn't believe all the things that had to change and move to get ready for last Thursday, which we sent some of the kids back, and Friday, and yesterday was the first day that they all were there.
Well, there now will come a lot more construction projects. We're not even finished, not even close, to repairing the damage from Ida, for example, at Ponchatoula High School, where the roofing contractor is under a lot of criticism right now.
Yeah, you know, Ken, but we're not giving up on that, obviously. We're holding our feet to the fire. And whatever's wrong, whatever we see messed up or not, we don't agree with or we didn't accept it, we're sending them back out there. So, yeah, it has a new roof, it'll have a new floor, but I can promise everybody that they're not leaving until it's done correctly.
But that's only one of so many other projects, especially in the Ponchatoula area.
Well, I think every school we had some kind of Ida damage. And then you look at, we just opened a new Yoakum Road facility. We had that ribbon cut the other day. And then we got the buildings going on at Champ Cooper. LaRonja Fieldhouse, if you just hadn't seen that, you need to ride by there and check that out, because that's turning into a beautiful facility. We got the Ponchatoula High School wing, the D.C. Reeves wing, and so there's a lot of construction going on. But like you said, there's still Ida stuff we're taking care of.
Well, we happen to be at a meeting of TRAC, that is the local anti-drug organization for young people, and the statistics on juvenile mental illness and drug abuse are off the charts, just staggering. What is there to say about it?
Well, you know, Ken, you're absolutely right. We're seeing it on our campuses, too. Blame it on COVID, blame it on the world, blame it on being shut up, blame it on whatever. But, yeah, this is a really extraordinary situation that we're in, with kids needing their counseling or needing group sessions or needing our help. So we need more, you know, our nonprofits that offer these services in the afternoon, what we offer during the school day. So it's something that we are addressing, absolutely, and it's becoming a problem.
Well, I have a theory, I hope it's correct, which is namely that as we get back to normal and each day we get a little bit more, that a lot of these problems from the pandemic will abate over time. You know, time has a way of healing all things. I just hope I'm right.
Well, you know, actually, Ken, I went to the Louisiana School Board Association meeting this year. It was in Baton Rouge. Our Southern Regional meeting was in New Orleans. I went to the first school safety quorum. It was in Baton Rouge Forum that Dr. Kate Brumley put on. But here's the first thing. Everybody's going through the same thing. Everybody's looking, suffering. The children are going through the same thing. But I think you're right. I think the start of this school year, not having to have masks, not having any social distancing, really COVID's the word that's way down the list now. Maybe that contributed to it. I hope so. And I think you're right. I think the more we get used to shutting the Chromebooks and get back in the classroom now, things will get back to a lot more normalcy than what we had.
For those who said we put too much into extracurricular activities, we can also say that theory has been debunked. Returning with sports and the other after-school programs, that's going to work wonders.
Oh, listen, I've never seen more excitement that we have going on our campuses with football season. Everybody's out there practicing, you know, getting ready for the jamborees coming up in a couple weeks. I think the scrimmages are next week. So, yeah, man, I think if you'd have been to the state championship games with Amite last year, football, Amite girls basketball, Amite boys basketball played for it, Punch Little Girls won the state championship, Punch Little Boys played the Superdome. Those were exciting times, and I can promise you, no one was thinking about COVID or being masked or all that during that time. So it's exciting days in our school with football season being here.
Well, in the meantime, you do have a Senate race that you're running, even though it's not on the fall ballot this year. It will be a year later.
Yes, next year. Qualifying's next July. You know, I tell people I'm running. That's my goal. I didn't run for school board this year because that's the reason why. And the things same like they are. I'll be qualifying for the new Senate District 37. I got a lot to say about it, a lot to say about it in the future. You know, I would like to say this. The day it was born, it was born in the back of Rogers Pope porch. Senator Pope and I sat down and kind of drew this thing out in 2019. And he took it from there to where we are today. And Beth Mizell is here today, and I told her she'll be the senator up north, which I'm going to support for Senate president, by the way. And I'll be the senator down south, and we'll make a great team.
Well, there's a big event coming up here at the arena in Amite, Married, Singled, and Divorced Conference. Erica Taylor from WABL, the local radio station, is the spark plug behind it. What do you have in mind?
What I have in mind is for everyone to come out and have a great time in the Lord. It's going to be lots of singing, dancing, comedy, poetry, excerpts from the Word of God, spoken words, food, fun, and fellowship.
You know, when you cover the categories of married, singled, and divorced, that's just about everybody.
That's everybody. It's rated E for everyone. And I have acronyms for married, single, and divorced. The acronyms for married are making a romantic rendezvous interesting every day. And for single is security in needing God's love every day. And for divorce is decisions initiating various opportunities relating to Christ every day.
You know, statistics prove that Americans these days, we're not happy as a nation. In fact, we're hurting.
We're hurting? Well, we have something for that. If everybody lean and depend totally upon the Lord God, they will find happiness because it's joy in serving the Lord. Amen?
All you have to do is go on Facebook where you'll read people complaining about their boyfriend or their marriage or their relationships or the opposite sex. And again, we need a lot of help, it would appear.
It's all about putting Christ first in any relationship. If Christ is first, then it will be a successful relationship, I believe.
So when is the conference going to be here?
The conference is going to be August 28th. That's the fourth Sunday in August. And the doors are going to open at 4:30. It's going to be open early for everyone to come in and get a seat. And it's going to start promptly at 5 o'clock until about 9 o'clock p.m.
So what's the cost?
The cost is $30. The tickets are on sale now. You can contact me at 225-432-9685. Or you can contact Evangelist Christopher Strahan at 225-200-6181, yes.
So how's the radio station going?
The radio station is going just fine. Just great.
What do you think of this Amite market now that you've been here a few months?
Well, it's going slowly but surely as I get to recognize and come to know everyone. You know, it's going slowly but surely.
Well, here we are in an Amite chamber event. Of course, the First Lady of the state, Donna Edwards, was the speaker. But still, there wasn't a seat available. It was a sellout, and a big success for the Amite Chamber.
It was a great sellout and a great success today. And I hope and pray that it be a great sellout on August the 28th.